it myself. Yeah, okay, hello everyone. I'm Dr. Abram Hindle from the Department of Computing Science at the University of Alberta. I recently started there. My research focus is on mining software repositories in order to extract software development processes from them and anything that is related to that. I've been recently changing gears into combining mining software repositories research with software power consumption research. And that's what today's talk is on. I guess more background. My supervisors at Waterloo were Rick Holt and Mike Godfrey. And I also did my postdoc at UC Davis with Graham Devon. Okay. So in this talk, Green Mining, a methodology of relating software change to power consumption, I'm going to talk about how we combine some of the tools for mining software repositories with the ideas of software power consumption and what causes that. So imagine the case that you've got your smartphone and your favorite app, in this case, lack of privacy, your favorite app, it's got an update. So you decide, yeah, I want to update that. So you go ahead, you tell it to update, it downloads code, and it changes the version of the software on the phone. It can also change the behavior. What can happen, though, is say, when you go to bed at night with your full battery because you recharged it, and you've set the phone to actually wake you up in the morning, is that this new code could have a bug in it. And then maybe the developers have to update the code. So in the middle of the night, the thing wakes up and checks, and there's an update. So it starts downloading this update. Now, this might not sound heavyweight, but it actually is. So when your phone wakes up, it's automatically using power. When your phone talks to the network, especially a wireless network, or even worse, 3G, or even worse, an edge network, you're going to even use more power because you have to power up the wireless antenna, and you've got to send stuff, and you've got to transmit. So downloading this update is actually going to consume quite a bit of power. As well, the software could incur further bugs. It could keep waking up and checking for updates. If the programmer's messed up and it was checking every minute for updates, your phone battery could easily be dead by the next morning, which in many cases is catastrophic because many people rely on their phones to actually wake up. Do you want to be responsible for someone not waking up the next morning? So, what can a programmer do? How does a programmer know that the changes they're making have an effect on power consumption? Furthermore, how do they know that whether or not they're introducing, say, a power bug, right? So what can they do? Do they know that their commits will actually induce power regression or not? So if you are a programmer, how can you tell what you're, so I'm asking you guys, you're making a commit, how is it going to change power use? How do you know? Like add more loops?
Test that?
Okay, test.
Yeah, there is the old-fashioned
test. Yes. Right, so we can test it. But testing requires that the test exists. So we have to build the test, right? Or it has to already be there. And that test has to basically cover maybe that changed code. Furthermore, does that test actually represent real-world scenarios? So a performance test, say like a regression test in MySQL, doesn't necessarily represent the actual use that a user would put it through, right? So you can do regression testing, and that will oftentimes tell you if there's a regression. You can also just throw it over the wall. You can give it to the users and hope for the best. This is really common, very common. So you might run your unit test, but then you throw it over the wall, and then if it kills a couple phones, people get back to you and you know you can fix it. But if you do this, you do lose the confidence of your user base, and you could actually lose them completely. Another option would be to, say, estimate power use. So by estimating, we could actually, say, not even run expensive regression tests, not even build expensive regression tests. We could estimate the impact of the power use of a software change. Unfortunately, this scenario requires a lot of data and a lot of modeling. So what I'm proposing is that maybe we collect a large corpus of power use correlated with software change, and then we will be able to use that to estimate the impact of your change. So so we're going to focus on part C here, but in order to get part C, we need part A. And part B isn't that useful because we already do that. All right, so what is green mining? Green mining is the combination of regression testing, static and dynamic analysis, all combined with software changes and mining software repositories research. Basically, what we want to do is we want to run tests on each change and record the difference in power use. Look for changes that induce a power change, and then keep a big corpus of these changes in a repository that allows us to say, look at code statically and say, well, you've already made a change like this, which did induce a power change. Maybe this new change you made, which looks like your old change, will actually induce the same thing. If this can be done immediately within a couple of seconds, it definitely beats a regression test, which, well, regression tests take time to run. A lot of time, they take a lot longer than a minute. And in order to get reasonable results from a regression test, stable results, you often have to run them multiple times. So even a 1 minute test would have to be run about 10 times. So it's 10 minutes on a change at the very least, assuming your regression test exists. When I built regression tests, or the power test, it was very time consuming. And there's a lot of problems that crop up. So what we want to do, and in this work, we're not quite getting here. We're mainly doing this part. What we want to do is we basically want to get a corpus of a lot of changes and code and the power consumption induced by that, right? And then that will allow us to help programmers in the future by basically telling them, oh, this code might actually induce a performance regression. So, green mining's goals. We want to reason about power consumption, the power consumption of source code changes, and we want to reason about it using a suite of regression tests that we've already run. It'd be really nice if I could take an external project and give it to you, and if that was relevant to your project, then we could actually estimate the power use of your new commit. That might work. We still have a lot of work to do to get there, but that's the end goal. So you might ask, well, we can already do CPU performance, and we can already sort of guess CPU performance. So why really bother with this power stuff when CPU is maybe the primary component? So I agree, the CPU is often the primary component. But a lot of things can use CPU without actually showing up on your radar. If your application keeps waking up, right? If it wakes up every second, but it doesn't do anything, it just maybe blocks again, puts itself back on the process queue, it will use CPU. Waking up and context switching will use CPU. And if you do this on a phone, you're going to be out of battery really soon. Causing that phone to wake up every second will cause the CPU to have to deal with the OS and will cause a lot of battery drain. So this really matters for software engineering, because if we use libraries with event loops, how the event loop is built has an impact on our power use, even if you're not doing any work at all, no computation. Furthermore, there's radio and Wi-Fi. Radios require antennas, and antennas required to be powered up. That uses quite a bit of power. So any kind of communication over wireless is a problem. It costs power, especially on the phones. On my laptop, if I use a 3G dongle, if I'm on edge, it's using 4 to 5 watts. If I'm on 3G, it uses like 1 to 3, depending. So that's quite a lot of power, actually. So at idle, this laptop uses probably 16, 18. So if it is adding about a fifth or a third power use just to communicate, that's a big deal. Furthermore, peripherals might not actually use a lot of power, like the little laser on your mouse doesn't use much, but the fact that your mouse is producing thousands of events when you move it, or hundreds, and they're inducing event loops and software, that causes power regression. Furthermore, your disk can really eat it up. So SSDs are a little bit better, but spinning disks, platters, they've got to spin up. If they were asleep, they have to spin up again. That's an electric motor that's got to turn on and go. As well, your kinds of reads matter and your kinds of writes matter. So if you are running, say, find on a Unix file system, a lot of those files aren't going to be in linear order. you're going to have that, you're going to have to be spinning around the disk accessing it almost randomly. So that can use a lot of power. Your memory, you have to keep the memory powered up, so memory is always a hit. But hitting the bus to access memory is a bit of a deal. You can loop, it costs some power to do that. Furthermore, if you run out of memory, any swap hit hits the disk, right? Any kind of time you have a fault and you got to go to the disk, that's more of a hit. So memory matters. The amount of memory you use, the order that you use the memory in, if it's in cache or not, because if it's in cache, then it'll be a lot better. But if it's got to hit the bus again, that uses power. Furthermore, your CPU primarily controls all of this and tends to use the most power anyways. So anytime you wake up the CPU, it has to come out of a sleep state and go into a higher level state in order to address your issues. So all of these things affect power consumption. And your software can affect every one of these. Receive or send, a sleep, a read, read or write, an allocation, even a deallocation, any kind of access to memory, responding to events, reading from a serial port, anything like that. Your software decides what's used here. The hardware guys already work pretty hard to make these things power efficient, but software engineers have some responsibility in the power performance of a system. So, who really cares? Well, there's already a lot of papers out on measuring power, so academia cares. Industry cares because power is a resource. Resource costs money. You want to reduce resource usage. Furthermore, you've got things that are limited, like batteries and mobile devices that can only last for a certain amount of time. IBM, Microsoft, Apple, they've all invested money in power for the server, power for mobile, power for desktop, power for laptop. The consumer cares about power because they have to pay the 14 to 25 cents per kilowatt hour, but they also have mobile devices. And if you use all the power on your mobile device, it's a brick. It's not useful until you power it up again. Environmentalists care because, at least in the US, where you have coal-fired power plants, basically every watt has a cost in CO2 and cost in pollution. Furthermore, mobile developers and mobile manufacturers care because power limits the use, limits the reliability and accessibility of their devices. So if you kill the battery doing simple updates, it's a big concern.
By the way, people are free to interject and interrupt at any time. So power is relatively important.
Previous work, industrial interest, green IT, Apple, Google, all the big guys, lots of academic interest from Microsoft Research, Purdue. Most of it tends to be in measurement and optimization. So there's a lot of work out about how to measure a laptop, how to measure a phone, how to measure this and that. There's a lot of work on that. In terms of optimization, people like, I think, Lee et al. Have measured, say, the cost of each CPU instruction. Other people have produced models of hard drive use and Wi-Fi use. Selby from Waterloo made optimizations that were explicitly supposed to be green. Basically, he tried to keep everything in cache in order to reduce power use, which might, in some cases, actually harm performance. And then there's a little bit of work in MSR. So Shang et al. From Ahmed's lab, they did some work on performance related to MSR. I've got a MSR and Xenir paper. This presentation's on the MSR paper. And from Microsoft Research, Gupta, Zimmerman, Bird, Nagapan, they've got a paper that might get into ICSM, I'm not sure. I think they submitted it. And so there's not a lot of work on combining power and MSR right now. So really, the novelty here is we're basically taking, you know, a clock and a radio and making a clock radio, right? We've got power, software power consumption, mining software repositories, combine the two, and we've got something useful. So, what do we do in this study? In this study, we first are going to look at the relationship between software change and power consumption. Then we're going to investigate various branches of Firefox and see how they relate to power consumption, especially a performance-related branch of Firefox. And then we're going to evaluate the BitTorrent client booze and see how it operates over see how power changes per revision. So each SVN commit, how does power change? And then we're going to try to see if we can relate software metrics to power consumption. So we've got two main research questions in this study. What are the effects of a performance-oriented branch on the power consumption of Firefox? This is an important question because if you try to improve performance, you don't necessarily improve power performance. If you use more CPU, if you use more events, and you get a faster system, you might use more power. So, when Firefox made a performance-oriented branch, did they save power? Second, with Booz, we're going to see what software metrics are relevant to power consumption based on what we measure. So in order to do this, we take normal regression testing methodology and we apply it using a bit of an MSR bend. So we choose a project. We choose to instrument the project. So do you want to record other things about the project while it's running, CPU, disk I/O, memory use, or are you just going to record power use? You choose the versions of the project you want to deal with. Also, how the versions are dealt with. Snapshots, versions, binaries, nightly builds, revisions. So we got to choose the versions. Then we develop use case tests. Now this is a little different than the regression test. The regression test, oftentimes you push the system at max performance to see what happens. That's not how users use a lot of software, especially desktop software. So we really want to make use cases that act like a user using the application. The user is not running GCC at the same time that they're browsing with Firefox. Well, most aren't. Many are just using Firefox straight, and they're being relatively idle doing it. They're consuming information. So we want use case tests that actually represent the actual user. Then we configure a test bed. We tell the test bed we want it to be relatively quiet. We want to record the certain aspects of it. And then we check out each version that we've chosen. We run the tests. Then we compile and store the results of these tests, whether locally or remotely. Then we clean up, and we keep repeating this for every version. So this is the real expensive part, and this is more so the MSR part. And then we analyze the end results.
So it's basic testing methodology.
So concretely, in case one, we chose Mozilla Firefox. We chose Firefox because it's popular, people use it, it's mobile relevant. You can download Fennec for your phone right now. It's resource intensive, it's long running. You leave it running on your phone, you leave it running on your desktop. So it's always running and often idle. And because it's so popular, if you have any kind of savings at all, it multiplies across the entire user base.
So small savings in Firefox can lead to a very large savings.
So to instrument the system, we use a
WhatsApp Pro.
So this thing's a USB power logger, so pass it around. And we use that to record the power use. We don't use ACPI, we don't use the laptop stuff because it requires you to use the battery circuitry, and that sometimes is a problem, as well as I don't have the thing in the box, so sorry. Bram's using it to test some monitors. All right. And then I use SAR and SysDev to record the CPU, the memory, the disk usage. And then I combine both of these measurements in our GreenLogger software, and that allows me to analyze and make models of, say, CPU disk usage versus power. And that was for both case studies. So for Firefox, we had to choose a version. We chose nightly builds, like all the nightly builds for the 3.6 branch from 2009 to 2010. And we also chose the builds for the electrolysis branch. So Firefox provides these builds to us. And these builds, so Firefox is C++, these builds were pre-compiled. These are not revision-based. These are an aggregate of the revisions during that day on that branch, checked out and compiled.
And we did that because it's very expensive to compile Firefox.
All right, so our Firefox test cases were meant to simulate a user browsing web pages. So we browsed four main web pages, the Wikipedia main page, which we mirrored on our own, the Battle of Vukovar page, which is a Croatian-Serbia battle, and two Nyancat mirrors, one using wget, one using Firefox. We chose Nyancat because it's this annoying animation, and we wanted to test the GIF animation features of Firefox versus Power. So we had those. And we remotely hosted these, but we mirrored them so they wouldn't change. The test bed that we ran this on was a ThinkPad X31 laptop. It runs a Pentium M processor, has a gig of RAM, We used Ubuntu 11.04. We popped out the battery. We turned off the screensaver. We tried to remove as many cron jobs as we could, disabling updates, what have you. And we put it into an aggressive power saving mode where it would also try to roof up writes on the disk. And we did that for Firefox and Booze.
I understand the necessity of removing variables so that you're working on one. But is this realistic? I mean, the effect of your application on the rest of the environment can be the dominant effect on power.
Yeah.
So the things that it does that disturb other things, like demons, may in fact be the dominant cause of power consumption.
Right. So we're measuring the whole environment, right?
Right. But if you're eliminating demons and making the system quiescent, that's not a normal running environment.
Okay. So that's true, but the updates are intermittent. These updates aren't running every second. These updates are running like once every couple hours. And so the issue with that popping up is you're not running the same test. So I want
to... I understand why you've done what you've done. I'm just saying that there's a lot of threats to this that are worrisome. So the other one is that I noticed that the browser things that you brought up were not ones that are dominated by ads, and that's unrealistic because most of the time somebody with a browser is looking at a site like, you know, Weather Network or whatever with tons of ads, or Facebook, and the ads are moving, and there's not much you can do about that, and I'll bet dollars to donuts they're eating up the power.
Ads do eat up the power because they're animations, and they're also flash, which is really poorly written in terms of power consumption.
Right. So, I mean,
so I didn't want to test the flash plugin.
Well, they're not always flash, but they're usually JavaScript or something. Yeah.
And furthermore, the flash plugin would complicate things in the sense that it changes over time and it's insecure, and running ads with an insecure flash plugin could actually affect my test bit. So,
right.
Yes.
I got it, okay.
Ads are a big deal, but I didn't want to test the flash plugin because everyone already knows the flash plugin eats up your battery pretty fast.
Yeah, my experience that's is really that different. If I want to triple my battery life on my laptop, I just install AdBlock.
Yeah, AdBlock will help you quite a bit.
But I mean, that's why he's also testing the animation and the
animation. No, I got it, yeah.
I mean, did you only disable the periodic updates, or did you disable all of it?
I disabled most of the events. So I had the Ubuntu event, the notifier.
Yeah.
So what happened was that came up once, so I left it open in the background, and it never comes up again, and it doesn't recheck when that thing's open. And I tried to make sure there was no real cron jobs, and all the disk indexers were turned off. Because the disk indexers are a big deal, because they come up once in a while, and then they'll put the laptop from 24 to 40 watts. So.
And the virtual machine daemons are a big deal, too.
Yeah, so I tried to make sure hardly anything was running on there, no services that were remotely accessible, things like that. Yeah, so there's a lot of different ways you can set things up. Maybe a default system is better, but a default system is going to give you a wacky test.
Yep.
You're going to run one test and it's just going to be wacky.
So, correct me if I'm wrong. So basically you're trying to set up a weird kind of test bed in which there are no interfering workloads and anything, you know, for example, daemon, etc., you know, as accessories, so that you can have a raw kind of model for the energy consumption of the application, right?
I want
as a baseline, you want
to
say. So that's why you're trying to bring up a kind of model or benchmark kind of test, stopping all the irrelevant loads.
So it's like having a scale and then putting the container on the scale.
Wires. Yeah, I got it.
And then once you know the container's cost,
so
you
what is the baseline cost? Okay.
Yeah. So the baseline cost was like about 18.
One last point. I just wondered if you thought of this. So the way you get around performance effects when you're measuring coverage is that you sample things, right?
Yeah.
So by time slice, you say, if I'm in here, that's where I am.
Okay.
Would it be practical to do something like that on a single processor for the application in its environment? That is to say, run the time slicer, if you're in the application, you sample the instantaneous power load at that point, and then go on. That way you could actually sample power consumption of the thing in its entire environment.
Yeah, well, the issue is that there's the hardware component, so it's very hard to really say, this software is using this.
Like, if you want to split everything out and you want to say Wi-Fi is using this, that sort of makes sense. What I do for the issue with the measurement is I just run it many times.
Yeah.
Instead of the sample.
Yeah, and you do the global.
Yeah. But definitely I'm trying to get an S-trace test up, which is nice because you can run all your power tests and then you can run S-trace later.
Right.
And then you can run S-trace a few more times and then you get sort of the average of the system calls. So I'm not doing the sampling thing, but I am running the tests multiple times because they definitely aren't that trustable, especially with, you know, different state, capacitors, cache state. Disk cache was a big deal in Linux.
Yeah.
Yeah, so things like that. There's a lot of confounds, and that's why the tests need to be run quite a bit. All right, so then we measured per version, and then this is Firefox. So I've highlighted the start, the page loads of the four different pages. Now, this isn't quite realistic because we restarted Firefox every time. So there's a big spike up to 40 here for the page, and then we go down to about 23, 24. Now, this looks funny because it is like 2,000 tests. This is 2,000 tests overlaid, and this is a density map. Why? Because there's a lot of noise in the testing. So you can see the sort of blue arc. Those are basically tests going up. The green areas are where there's a lot of test measurements, right? Because you do get a lot of measurements all over the place. So we've got seconds here, and we've got watts here. And basically what happens is Firefox starts up, loads up Wikipedia. We idle for a bit. The test runner is going page up, page down, and moving the mouse around. So we're getting mouse overs and things. And then kill, start the next Firefox, and then Wikipedia again. Kill, start Nyancat 1, and then we can see that there's a difference here in power. Nyancat has this cat like this that is oscillating in the middle of the page, and it's got this blinking star background. So there is more power use here, mostly due to the animation of Firefox. So more timers are being run, the graphics is being pushed a bit more. And then we try the second Nyancat, it's a little bit less. So this was about a 10-minute test. And we ran this test, I don't know, about, I guess if I count electrolysis tests, about 3,500 times. So, you know, multiply that by 10 minutes, it took a while. So this is the results of all those tests, broken down per version. We've got we got watts on this side, we got versions along here. We got 2.0 over here, which used quite a bit, especially for Nyancat. And then we got about 3.6 starting around here. And then 3.6 is relatively stable, but the older stuff tended to use more. So over time, Firefox's general performance has been improving, and that has been showing up in power performance.
When you're running the cat animation, I know it has music in it. Do you think it matters if
the
sound's
on or
off? Oh, okay.
It matters because I think they use an SWF. They're using a flash plugin to play music, so it really matters. And also, when you're talking to the sound card, you're always filling the buffers, so it's already a lot of work. So yes, I think it matters. Music goes on. Okay. So we've got power use decreasing over time. 3.6 is relatively flat. The change here isn't much. And there's quite a bit of variance showing that you do need to run these tests quite a bit. The average was about 24 watts for 3.6. Then we took the electrolysis branch of Firefox. This is that performance-based branch that I talked about. Chromium, Google made the Chromium browser, and one of the big things with the Chromium browser was tabs were separate pages and separate tabs were separate processes. So there was isolation, but there was an IPC cost. So what Firefox did is they said, well, that looks useful, let's do it. They wanted to improve user performance. They wanted to improve the usability. They wanted to improve the latency for the user. They wanted the UI to be a bit snappier, things like that. So they decided to sort of copy Google and make this per process, like a per process per tab kind of model. And what happened was, is they actually did reduce the power use. So they got less than 24 watts. It did go up near the end there, but this is in the 4.0. So we look at the 3.6, and it's already lower than 24, and it goes up a little bit to
bit above 24 for 4.0. But nonetheless, their architectural change, which was relatively severe, to actually break Firefox out from this threading model, this big giant C++ program with threading, into a multi-process model, actually gained them both usability performance, like it was less latent, it was a little snappier, as well as they reduced power consumption.
So I'll show you the difference.
So here's the Mozilla 1.9 star branch, which is 3.6. So this is the mainline stuff. And we can see that it's pretty tight and it's above 23.8. The electrolysis branch is a little bit dispersed, but its average is much lower. There's about a 0.25 to a 0.27 watt savings there. So they actually gained a savings in power. And so this is a summary of 2,000 tests and 1,500 tests.
But that's 1%.
It's less than 1%, yeah, on the total power consumption.
Right.
For a huge architectural change.
A huge architectural change, which could have increased power use a lot just by allowing the system to be more snappy. If they would have increased timers and things like that, you could have had far more events occurring, and you could have used a lot more battery. Their purpose here was not power consumption. Their purpose was to increase user performance. So the usability of the system, the snappiness, its responsiveness. And that could have impacted power performance quite a bit, but it didn't.
But that's actually, if you think about it, that's not that surprising, because one of the ways to increase the snappiness is to stay away from resampling the network, and since the radio card is the dominant power drain on the box, that maybe that's not so surprising.
So, yeah,
perhaps.
Yeah, just to support, I mean, the same thing. I missed one of the slides in which you had a test bed set up. Mm-hmm. So you were doing these tests on a laptop machine?
Yeah.
And that was with a power, right?
Yeah.
Power supply. And starting with your example, I mean, the motivation which really struck me was basically to reduce energy so that these mobile devices, you know, that are important to reduce their battery.
Right, but that's a mobile device.
Yeah, but in this case, mostly, you know, if the user is using it, it's a good step. I'm saying it mostly in the case of the user is using the laptop, and it will not help him to wake in the morning. He will not set up those kind of timers. If he sees the battery is low, if he's using watching a movie, he will stop it. It's good to cut on the power on it. But in case of mobile devices, for example, if they have to make a transmission, and transmission is really expensive, like I guess most expensive, and receiving is 1/4, and the processing is the least. So I agree there it will make a difference, but basically most of it will come from the transmission and receiving part.
Well, it depends on the network. So if they're on Wi-Fi, it's not going to matter a lot, especially for a browser where you've loaded the page up and then you're reading the page.
Yeah, but Wi-Fi, well, the point is that even with Wi-Fi, the dominant power is thing on your laptop is radio, period.
No, it's a CPU.
Not if you're under animation.
So CPU and disk on the X31, and on this one.
Oh, is it? It's definitely not on a newer one.
It's definitely radio. I was doing some of the stuff, but not with the laptop, with the radio transmitters, the sensor. So the cost of reading a disk and is more in CPU, because in mobile devices, even now the transmitter is based on TI-1000 transmitter and receiver. So that is really dominant. The amount it takes to transmit a bit is like based on the propagation model. But in this laptop, the peripheral takes much more energy.
Right. But you guys also got to integrate. Remember, power use is basically the summation of your power use over time. So this integration here, if we look here, the network use is right here, right?
Yeah.
There's network use. Yes, it peaks up. But that is not the main component. The main component is the time here, where you're browsing and you're moving the mouse around and you're actually reading it. So you have to integrate over here in order to get the whole power. So yes, these spikes do matter.
Oh, I see. So you're saying that the human interaction over time is dominated by CPU.
Right. So it matters on your test. So if your test is, let's hammer this thing 10 megs a second over Wi-Fi, yeah, that's going to matter.
But there are figures around that say that, you know, an average user using a laptop in an average way, the dominant power loss in the machine is the network. Right. So well, you can actually tell that you can do that experiment yourself. Just turn your Wi-Fi card off. You'll see an enormous change in the that you notice immediately in the battery life. So
it's a couple of watts, but your screen matters more than your Wi-Fi.
What's that?
The screen brightness matters more than your Wi-Fi.
That depends on the screen technology. On that machine, I agree with you.
Yeah. So it does depend on the machine, and that's an annoying aspect.
Yes.
All right, so I can still do this. So we got the VUS project, which is a BitTorrent client. Now, what's interesting about BitTorrent is you leave this thing running in the background to download your legal Ubuntu disk images, because that's all you're using BitTorrent for.
Absolutely.
Exactly. Anyways, so that means it's I/O bound. You use the network and the disk. So it's got to talk on the network. It's got to write to the disk. But its disk stuff is random. Because they use random algorithms in order to ensure random redundancy in the cloud. Unless you're using VUS and you tell it not to do that and you ruin the cloud redundancy because you don't know what you're doing. Anyways, so it's long running, it's I/O bound, it's got cryptography in it. So you've got encrypted connections, you've got hashing of all the blocks you're writing to disk, you've got verification of blocks on disk using hashing, so that's CPU. It's also got a user interface, and this user interface is plugins. So it's an interesting case study. We checked out 45 versions and compiled them. And so we used the revisions from 26300 to 26800, and that was about a couple of months. And then we measured the CKJM OO metrics for them. We had two tests, an idle test where you start up and you try to seed, although in our case we didn't have anyone to seed to, but it sits around and it waits for someone to connect in order to send files. And then we also had a leech test where it downloads a file for 10 minutes. And the goal was to simulate basically average use cases, but BitTorrent is hard to test because you need multiple machines. I had one server that acted as a tracker and the provider in many cases, the main seeder. Also, VUS was irritating because it has annoying UI quirks. For instance, various versions like to pop up Firefox to show you the VUS block, and other versions like to pop up little pop-ups that say, do you want to download this download accelerator, and others kind of adware. So my GUI driver had to watch for this and kill it, which was irritating.
And it happens a lot. So the results?
This is what, I think this is 900 tests, this is 500 tests. So for the leech and seed tests, or for the seed test, we start up VUS, it initializes, and then it has to check to see if this 2 gigabyte random file is legit. So it reads all the blocks of the file, hashes them, and makes sure that they match the torrent file, which describes that file. And then after it's done verifying, so this is the impact of mostly disk, it sits and waits. Notice that this is 21 watts. The idle for that computer was probably 18 to 19 watts. Idling, VUS uses quite a bit. Then there's the leech test. The leech test, we initialize, we connect, we start talking with the seeder, we start initializing a sparse file on the file system, about 2 gigabytes in size, and then we start downloading blocks until most of the file sort of exists, and then we keep downloading blocks at a rate of about, I think, 3 megs a second. And then around here, we verify that the blocks exist, and then it sort of tails off. So in 10 minutes, we download 2 gigs. And you can see here that it's using quite a bit. It's above 24. So it's like a Firefox animation. And the interesting thing about this is you'll be running VUS in the background. You're not interacting with VUS. VUS is running on its own because you're downloading big legal files. All right. So the idle test across versions was very stable. There was a little bit of a dip here, and it is statistically significant, but it dipped there. They were the average was above 22.5. So these were the seeding tests. So it verifies and then just sits and waits. The leech test used a lot more. We can see here this is 23.8 watts, and there's a slow decrease over time. This change right here actually decreased power use for a while, and then it sort of picks up a little bit. This change is actually a bunch of UI tweaks. So they weren't using SWT. They weren't using SWT sort of correctly, and they started making some sort of UI bug fixes. And that actually, that group of changes tended to reduce power use. So the UI actually mattered in this case.
So what is the average values for the test you made, or just a single test?
This is 900, or this is 500 tests.
So just wondering, normally what happens when you're in an ideal test, that's okay, you can get the energy. But when you start running the multiple tests, so people claim that, you know, the heat lost in the circuitry, even your hard disk, and for the CPU, it can be up to 20-30% more. The energy lost in the circuitry. Did you see the reflective change in subsequent tests? Just from my interest, or it was just the same?
No, it was in power saving mode, so it wasn't getting that hot anyways. So like that laptop can hit 40 or 70. If I have it on full, it goes 40 to 70. So full CPU, full disk, it goes 40 to 70. But this is in an aggressive power saving mode, so it wasn't that warm. So the laptop was never that hot, and the fan wouldn't kick up.
Yeah, so heat is a big issue, especially in the server space where you're going to spend a lot of time on fans. And so in the server space, it's irritating because the machines around you affect your power use.
How many times you use them, yeah.
Yeah. All right. So there was a difference between the two tests, the idle and the leech test, quite a bit. But we still see that the idle test is using quite a bit. You know, with idle being, with actual machine idle being around 18, 19, this is sucking down quite a few watts. This is almost like having Wi-Fi on. So that's a bit of concern. So then we tried to relate this to metrics. And unfortunately, because we only had 45 versions, even though we had hundreds of tests, by only having 45 versions, it blew away any chance of significance. So those things that were significant and correlated were like depth of inheritance and a few other measures that were sort of correlated. So a change in depth of inheritance showed some promise. We had a relatively good correlation of 0.3 or above 0.3 Spearman-Rowe. And the p-value was okay, it was 0.01. But this is basically a fishing expedition. So when we correct for multiple hypotheses, the p-value is thrown out. So we didn't have enough, right? So we didn't get a good result on metrics. Basically, we need more versions in order to be able to safely say anything about metrics for these tests. And the power reduction we did see in Booz was mostly due to the UI tweaks, which probably had to deal with how you repaint or update. Okay, so what we found, lock. Finally, something that lock doesn't correlate with. Aren't we lucky? So lock is normally known to correlate with defect proneness and other things like that. But in this case, lock doesn't actually correlate. Change in lock doesn't actually correlate. The system slowly increased in size over time, and both of them sort of slowly reduced in power use, but not a lot. Booz lock was pretty stable where we tested it, and it actually reduced in power consumption. Firefox slowly increased lock, but reduced again. There wasn't really a clear straight-up correlation there, so that's interesting. Was CPU measurement enough? So using linear regression models, we found that there was a gain when you included other measures, other peripherals like memory and disk. Now in a linear regression model, if you include more variables, your R-squared tends to go up anyways. But these other components improve the whole model. So in the Firefox test, memory and disk mattered. So what we were modeling here was the per second power use based on the CPU use and the disk use and the memory use at that second. And so we were able to get a reasonable model with R squared 0.38 doing that. With Booz, because the models were so, because the data was so stable, the linear models couldn't really deal with that. Well, it's not linear, it's pretty like two values. So the R squared values were lower, but when we included the disk in the Booz models, because it was BitTorrent, it was dealing with the disk, we did get a better result. So we found that peripherals like the disks do matter. So CPU isn't enough. And a good example of that, like an artificial example, would be you run find on your computer, or you run a disk indexer.
it's not going to use a lot of CPU, but it's going to use a lot of power because it's going to start walking through the disk and opening files and dealing with stuff like that.
So we found that peripherals matter.
So for future work, we have to do more tests. We need more data in order to safely reason about stuff. We want to get to the point where we can take a new system and find maybe a similar older system that's been tested and then relate that such that we can have estimates of your system and changes to your system. So I might be doing some work with Chanchal in the summer and maybe we'll get somewhere there. So we also want to look at the relationship between power consumption and features at different levels of granularity. So here we're using OO metrics. I want to get down to source code. I want to look at source code tokens. I want to look at packages. I want to look at classes. I want to look at DLLs, system calls. There's a lot of stuff to look at right now. And some, like the Microsoft researchers, have been looking at, say, like syscalls and library calls. So those might show some interest, because the system calls and library calls tend to call out to peripherals and induce power consumption. If we get more of this, then we can actually inject, say, an annoying Clippy-like character into your IDE, which warns you about possible power regressions and maybe suggests ways to fix it. As well, we want to produce recommendations for the average programmer to follow. There's already a bunch out there, but some of them sort of ignore the important things like events and your event loop. They tend to focus more so on, say, you know, just using a peripheral or using a lot of CPU. So in conclusion, for our first research question, developer effort to improve performance ended up improving power performance. Were software metrics related to power use? Not so sure. It's also a static measure, so it's questionable at best. But what we found was, with Firefox reducing the use of the electrolysis, reducing power use in the electrolysis branch, if you multiply that small savings by many of the user, like a subset of the Firefox users, 4 million users is just a tiny subset of Firefox users, that if 4 million users actually downloaded that new version and actually ran it, you'd be saving about 1 megawatt per hour. And 1 megawatt per hour is equal to about 1 American household month of power use. So that's actually pretty interesting. So multiple people together can be aggregated to actually save power. Now there's going to be a lot of waste in the average consumer household, but the point is that power doesn't have to be used. Furthermore, even if it was batteries, that power could be used for other things. So it's not just savings, it's also you could use those resources for something else. We studied the effect of power and change over time, and we did it from a sort of user-centric point of view. We didn't want to just, you know, put the machine on its knees and make it run as fast as it can. We wanted to actually simulate what a user might do, what a user might expect from the power performance. And from this, we hope that we can use some of this data and produce more data, maybe collaborate with others in order to vivify the green mining goals of having a corpus of software changes, the induced power use, and being able to use that to make recommendations based on the code you're currently typing. All right, thank you. Any questions?
How realistic do you think to get into actually collect a good repository? Because it depends on the scenario.
All right, so I am not that concerned about the machines. I think the machines can be dealt with by having their own special coefficients which deal with that model. So some machines, disk will matter more. Some machines, CPU will matter more or less. Some machines will have very complicated CPU disk models. So I'm not too concerned about the machine. The machine's always going to change. But what I am concerned about is getting enough changes tested, and I'm having problems with that. I think what's going to happen is we're going to take a test, run it, model it, and then run it in the cloud, instrument it, and then estimate its power use. I think we're not going to be able to rely on actual power use. Or you run the test a couple of times on your machine or on the test bed, and then you watch the other things like power, CPU, and all that. And then you put it on the cloud, and then you just sort of interpolate. I think that's what probably is going to happen. Or you full out simulate in an image, and with all the counters, hope that you're going to get the similar results. So I think you got to make the models and run them in the cloud in order to get this repository done.
But is the similar problem happening in performance world as well? That kind of like somehow the performance of the new system?
Well, I'm not totally sure, but I really want to use what the performance world has. But the performance world doesn't seem so use case based.
So the thing is, depends on what you mean when you're looking at the performance.
Yeah.
So basically, the green thing in cellular devices has been there for a long time. But people are not, I guess, they're not reducing it into this laptop thing.
Yeah.
The primary reason is because they know, like, laptop battery will, as I said, will not die right away. And if you're at the airport, definitely you want to consume power. The goal is economy, economy based, you want to reduce the power per house consumption. But for example, in palm devices, wireless sensors, they're already doing that in a similar way, that how much energy is consumed when you transmit, let's say, this much range of data, how much energy is consumed when you receive it, or propagation model, or, what happens if you have these kind of sound card, how much is there, and then what they do is, doesn't matter what device it is, based on the model, same thing as you said.
Yeah. But what I really want to do, I really want to make this clear, it's a relationship of the change to the induced power use. I really want to enable developers to know what happens when they make that change, because these tests are really expensive to run, and developers aren't going to have all the regression tests set up. Unit testing is hard enough, and very few ever get reasonable coverage with unit testing, even though they brag about it. Regression testing is far harder. You need a real test bed. Like just running it on your laptop, yeah, it's sort of questionable.
Yeah, but the OS folks do that. They have canned workflows that they use on their new models of laptops and operating systems for them,
yeah,
which they run through and measure. So measure the power consumption of the whole system, and try to discover where the power goes and tune their operating systems version by version to reduce power.
Right, but that's at the OS level where it's very capable to do that. The application programmer and the server programmer, so ignoring OS, is responsible for power use, and the OS people aren't necessarily responsible for how those people code.
No, they take it into account in their total system use, but yeah.
Yeah, as well, industrial measures like the Intel battery benchmark. They do run Firefox, but it's a very poor test. It doesn't run like a real web page. So while you could have benchmarks, whether or not your benchmarks are relevant is an issue as well.
So basically you're getting an energy-aware development.
Yeah, it'd be nice to know if you're making a change that's going to induce a performance or power regression. And the great thing about it is performance related, so you can use all that.
Did you know about the case of Nexus S by Google?
The battery regression or?
Yeah, exactly. They, for example, before they started to distribute the last version of Android and the beginning of January, they had to stop. They started to do what you mentioned as just throw over the wall. Mm-hmm. So in less than 1 week, they had to stop the distribution because they found that one of the new changes that they applied to the Android port was causing the consumption of battery to increase. Mm-hmm. So they had to wait 3 months to start again to distribute the new version with a new date in order to fix that problem. That's a real case in the industry that happened because of change in the software.
Yeah.
There was an iOS example too.
Yeah, there's been quite a few iOS examples. And a lot of them come out of the fact that people do use it. Like, it's noticeable to people when they're late for work. And so the iOS example affected a bunch of people because it left their phones dead. As well as any kind of Apple date time mess up tends to get the news because people don't wake up for work. Yeah, so it's a new world. I'm currently collaborating with Occam's Lab right now, and there's a lot of neat stuff to be done.
It's a neat thing to combine with MSR work. And also, it's not quite low-hanging fruit because it requires some heavy footwork to get there. So, very cool.
Good.
All right, thank you, guys.
Very cool.
Thanks.
Okay.
You like it?
Yeah. I'd be interested to see if it's different on the newer hardware.
Yeah, it matters on desktop machines too.
Yeah, but there are also desktop machines optimized for power consumption. So, but basically they're laptops. So like the Mac Mini sort of thing, right? I mean, those things are like 1 watt on idle, and that's incredibly good. What it would do is if you use such a platform to do the measurements, is it would actually magnify the